out towards the main branch, we'll begin to do buildings in just a bit once we make the turn and get out of here. In terms of our four stars, the first one is represented by Fort Dearborn, the westernmost post of the United States. We get by the Michigan-Amity Bridge, which you all know, it's been renamed Usama. We'll point out that site. The second happening that ranked one of these four stars, Lakeshore Drive Bridge, was done around the same time the lock was, about 1937. And this is what we call a Basco bridge. And most of you know the leagues race like this. Basco, the French word for teeter-totter or seesaw. Remarkably unaltered are these four towers, look on either side on either end. Hugh Young, the engineer, did these in about 1937. We call them Art Deco or Art Fashion. The past that's represented here is the window design. These are similar to Louis Sullivan's windows in Carson Perry Scott, the department store in St. Madison. Now the locals know the store is long since closed. The building's intact. It's now called Sullivan Center, but do you all know who's moving in the lower levels? Target. Yes, exactly. So it's a big change down there, but that's the window design. Now Solomon Cordwell Benz turned this hotel towards the river. Even in 92, we didn't view the river the way we do today. Huge ballroom dining complex, built-in security for visiting dignitaries. I will never forget the year the president was staying here. That day, the boat hit a trail way over here along this bank. The Columbus Drive Bridge in front of us, the leaves were in the upright position. So world leaders may opt to stay there and share it. This is another Basco Bridge. This is the second largest in the world. There's 7 lanes of traffic above us, 2 10-foot sidewalks. It's about 10 years older than the hotel, so we use the data about 1982. On the right-hand side, this piece of sculpture affixed to the bridge. She's Chicago rising from the lake, done by Milton Horn in the mid-50s. She was on a downtown parking garage that got demolished. The city kept the piece, just like they did at home. We do at home. They forgot where they put it. A few years ago, added to the bridge. On your right, does that remind you of Rockefeller Center in New York, just a little? That's our NBC Tower. Skip on, oh my goodness, look at the window washer. Don't ever say your job is hard. That's a great photo if you've got the right lens on your camera. Almost parallel to the window washer, you see those shoulder projections or what we call flying buttresses? For those of you unfamiliar with the term, it's as if your elbow's bent like this, with your arm upraised. Those are very contemporary. They're paying tribute to some earlier buttresses. We'll see in just a minute if we get a little further west. This is University of Chicago's downtown campus on your right. Grad School of Business, several other programs housed here. Of course, the main campus is on the south side. Side Tower comes in second. This is by Eastern architects Pickard and Chilton. It's what we call an energy efficient or green building. Pull in some of the river waters and pull it. It's called 300 North LaSalle. It's all offices. And to me, looking at it, it's why do we locals call this Goose Island? Well, you certainly see the geese all around. I have to tell you, Irish immigrants both belong to the Tribune. And we made such a fuss about the building that won the competition a little bit ago on the main branch. What's this huge structure we're approaching here over here on the right?
This is a 5-story. This is the decks in the balcony, the triangular windows, the round portal windows. Next door one is 5. The third one there is 6 stories, and the last one is 6. And there's all the different decks and balconies. Aren't they amazing? You can get a little boat slip. Now, he did not live there. He lived in Old Town on Willow Street, and he passed, not that many years ago, he did pass in Willow Street.
On the other hand, I'm waiting for one of you to discreetly say how much you love this. They've never changed hands since they opened 1988, 1989. It's the same 4 families, or perhaps they've given them to their children. We've never seen them on the markets.
There's these active train yards that take precedence over anything anybody might want to develop here.
This branch has actually moved over a little bit over further to the west in the 20s. But look at the building here behind it. A little bit further they moved it over, not quite at this point. The train tracks come first, and then behind it, do you see the building with the balconies added? That's Butler Brothers. Any of you from Boston, Butler Brothers started out there as a wholesale mail order in 1877. They came to Chicago 1879. Then that building is 1922. And see the balconies have been added as residential. I will never forget, 8 seasons ago, maybe 9, Passenger raised his hand. He said, that's my condo in the old Butler Brothers. He was so proud that he lived there. You know the question we had for him? Trains in your side yard. It's the Metro and the Amtrak that go in the side yard. Can you hear the clickety-clack of the elevated train behind us? You need to look around, but it's going over by his front door, the elevated train. So the question was the noise, and his response is what you would expect. You seem to get used to it. Right there. Now next door, the trains continue, they go underneath. And if you look above, the sign says Boeing, business was Morton International. It was done about 1990. It was done by Ralph Johnson of Perkins and Will. Look at this clock if you wish. That is one of the tallest clock towers anywhere in the world, atop the Boeing Center, way at the top of the building, on a postmodern building. Postmodern pays tribute to the past. Remember in the past, long before us. In the past, major buildings might have a clock atop. Not all of us would have had a pocket watch or a wristwatch back then. So this end of the building has the clock as a postmodern record. Happened a few seasons ago. That's not the tallest building in the world. That is the tallest building in the Northern Hemisphere. It was done in 1974, it opened around that time. It was done by Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill. And we're gonna talk a lot about it in detail when we get a little bit closer to it. But for now, while you're enjoying the view, I'm gonna get us out of fire mode. If we were riding the boat together the day before the blaze, look around at each other, one out of three of us would be homeless, 36 hours later. And I only have time to make one point. We'll get to this building right here on our right. Historians argue today it is not so much the rebuilding of our city after the fire, sort of figuratively put us on the map. We must include also the World's Fair, both of them together. You know, in fact, you came today to do architecture, not history, but the same point applies there. You can't really talk about Chicago's architecture without referencing this fire in 1871 that destroyed everything, and then the fair, which brought so many people to see the incredible buildings. That was only 1930. And that was done by Halliburton. That's that deco again, the verticality. See how your eye goes up and down and those windows are recessed. That building being the tallest in Chicago for several decades. Look at the top. She is Ceres, the Roman goddess of grain, agriculture, sculpted by John Storrs. On the back side, you're gonna see a 1980 addition in a minute. And remember when we said Helmut Jahn did that silver blue glass that cascaded down behind the Daily News? Someone looked at that and said, that's the cash register shape. So what Jan did instead, we have to wait till we get right past these trees, he mimicked the original building. He put a white circular piece on top. It looks like it should be on your car, like a hood ornament. It represents the pit, the trading floor. There it is. And then see the blue pyramidal glass roof? It's not nearly as tall. Now I'm standing. So you see right behind the Board of Trade, much lower building. That's the 1980 postmodern edition. Some people say that's a lovely blending of old and new. Next up for you, Devil in the White City fans, is one of Burnham's last buildings. Look at the one. Off-white glass for columns. See the squared-off roof and the off-white glass for columns? Dan Burnham did the northern end of that in 1910 and he passed in 1912. That's called the Insurance Exchange Building. This end was done much later in the late 20s. Next, you can see the balconies hanging on this new building. It says 235 Van Buren and its base. Obviously residential with the balconies. It's done by Ralph Johnson of Perkins and Will. This one was done very recently. It opened about 2010 or so. And look at the balconies. It already has three nicknames. Because the balconies don't match, it's called dot dot dash building. It's called Lego block building. And it's also called Jenga block. You know, those things you have to pull out and it all comes out. But whatever you see when you're looking at that, that's a new residential right away. Next, we'll come up with the biggest reinforced concrete. We'll be coming the bridge. Of New York, and this one has that gray cylinder rising out of it at the top. If you're down here tonight looking at Willis, this is almost like a show-off building. That cylinder is so illuminated, I think it's pink now because of breast cancer month, but it's got like 1,700 fluorescent tubes in it. Amazing. Next door, of course, is Willis. Let's spend time on Willis. How can that building go to 1,450 feet and withstand the wind? If you look at it, it's nine buildings clumped together. See how part of it goes to 50 stories, some make it to 66, a few go to 90, the last two go all the way to 110. The analogy is made, it's only nine stars can have like this. They're very tight. There's much more strength than with one solid hit. And who do we owe? That is engineering genius. Within Skidmore, the Bangladesh born Dr. Masla Khan, came up with this bundling. And he did this with Bruce Graham and the architect. Together they were quite a team. They did the John Hancock, also people with the Hancock, but he had such great team going to start the business with the whole architecture, engineering, whatever you want to call it, it's pretty amazing. And you know what? The building is all sway. Not enough to buy for us, but you know, of course they are meant to do such. Now if you want to see the view, you see them? Watch your eyes. That's the ledge. That's pretty amazing if you did that and you weren't even too frightened. I have to say, it's only been open a few seasons and the opening today. I had some kids aboard in the afternoon who had already done the ledge.
Oh, we surpassed that.
I had somebody this season, a mother pull a photo out of her purse of her daughter, who's a cheerleader. She's doing a cartwheel on the ledge. And there were some other teachers, believe it or not, who were here and said they did a pyramid on the ledge. So all the teachers on top of each other. Anyhow, you don't even have to go out. If you just want to go up there and look and see the view. She invented it. Next door to the GFN building, we call that where the train is passing through, the one with a very dark gray facade, stainless steel mullions, very new looking building. The train will probably stop right in front of it. Comes the train the other way. I must say that building was done by Cohen, Pedersen & Fox, that New York firm that did the pinkish one just south of Willis. They did this one about 2002, but you know what I like to point out about that site? In 1860, they constructed the building approximately on that site in 5 weeks. That is when Abe Lincoln received the Republican nomination for president. It's called the Wigwam. Long gone. Next door are the beautiful curvy green facade structure. This is Nuveen, N-U-V-E-E-N, or 333 West Wacker. Cohen, Pedersen & Fox did this one about 1983. Aren't those reflections amazing? I have to tell you, over all the years I've been here, passengers sometimes say they are so gorgeous, they look like they're painted on them. Of course they're not. But some years after that building opened, not very long, I can't really remember when, so you might. The tribute hosted a competition that said Chicago, vote for your favorite building. The meat one. I don't know if they went again today, but they didn't have that time. Now, next door here is another Cohen, Pedersen & Fox. Three in a row on the main branch of the river, and then they did the one south of Willis. This one here, the 225 West Wacker, is called Pedersen & Fox. It's a local firm, Perkins & Will. It's about 1989. Watch your eyes. It won the Pritzker Award of Architecture. Not for that building. It's given to a living architect for all his work. Now, we don't make much of a fuss, but just because it comes in third in terms of height, I do want to mention it. It's A on it to all of us. It was Standard Oil, a big stand when it opened. It was done about 1973 by Network Invest on Perkins & Will. You know what? It was the tallest building for a few months because Sears opened in 1974, which is the title way. So real quickly, the tallest one, of course, is Willis, the old Sears. Second is Mr. Trump's. Third is that one there, which we call Aon today, not Standard Oil anymore. And fourth, of course, is the John Hancock. Yes, of course. And I will say,